Hi guys, welcome back, and it is the week in the build-up to the coronation coming this Saturday, and I am super excited. I've bought a new dress, I'm going to visit a friend up in Ascot, and we're having a bit of a party, we're watching it live on a big screen, and it's going to be epic. Now, I've had a few messages from people saying, why am I not in London, in the thick of it? One, I will not be able to see anywhere near as much as what I will be able to from the enjoyment of having my own space, a bar service, and obviously a big screen. Secondly, I went to a Fatboy Slim concert years ago, and they've moved it from Brighton on the beach, where everyone could party on the beach, to this really narrow, long road called Madeira Drive. And I got crushed with my friend. It was only about 60-second crowd crush. But ever since then, the thought of being around that number of people, I can't get out of the space. It triggers my panic attacks, so that's why it's not really for me. I would rather sit with friends and drinks and nibbles and enjoy watching it in a relaxing environment. Now, speaking of going to London, there are lots of people visiting, tourists from everywhere, all around the world. People are piling into the UK to be here on this historical moment. But the bit that's getting all of the ladies excited, and possibly some of the gents as well, is the amount of military uniforms. They are everywhere. They are piling onto train stations. They are on the underground tubes. They are spilling out of every station to come for rehearsals, for the band processions. And there are lots and lots of rehearsals that are going on. Some are happening as early as dawn. Obviously, the roads aren't busy and they can actually concentrate. And some lucky people that can actually wake up at that time of the day have captured some amazing, beautiful photographs. The fact that these are just rehearsal parades tells you everything at how big Saturday is going to be. I've been getting really frustrated with the media because they keep just putting out, this is being cancelled, they're not doing this, they're going woke, Charles is doing this. And it's like they're trying to depress people and put people off going, well, I'm not going to watch it if it's going to be like that. Just give it a go. If you don't like it, turn it off after 10 minutes. I'm not believing any of the stories. Some of the stories going around are Catherine, the future queen, is not going to wear a tiara and instead is going to wear flowers in her hair, painting it almost like she's going to wear a dress like mine, very 70s, and come skipping down the aisle. I am not believing any of this. Now, there's absolutely nothing wrong with Catherine wearing flowers in her hair. Catherine could wear a bin bag in her hair and everyone would still be like, oh, doesn't she look beautiful? Because she can carry anything off. But there is just so much gossip going around now, and I am just going to sit back and watch it all unfold, and then I can talk to you about what actually happened when we come back next week. Now, there's a cute little bit of footage here that has been posted around social media. It's from the King Charles Instagram account. It's Charles and Princess Anne when they were very little at their mother's coronation, and they are behaving like normal little children do. They are running around, they're tugging under the Queen's robes, the Queen Mother, they dash underneath, and there's a very, very cute, sweet moment at the end where Princess Anne looks at Prince Charles covering his face, and then she does exactly the same. And isn't that just adorable? Thus proving it doesn't matter who you are, children will always be children. They will always muck around and make the best of even the most serious of days in history. Now, speaking of serious, there was an incident that actually happened outside Buckingham Palace. It's all been resolved now, but it involved a man being detained and arrested, I believe under the Mental Health Act, for throwing certain objects, shotgun cartridges, inside the palace grounds. This then in turn involved the man being arrested, and then the police carried out controlled explosions. Now, this was actually captured live, and the man that talking is Jacob Rees-Mogg. He's one of our MPs. Now, what happens in this clip, which I'm about to show you, is an actual real life version. You know, the stiff upper lip and British people just get on with it, that sort of mantra, the posters, keep calm and carry on. Well, this is the perfect example of Brits doing what we do best, and that is keeping calm and carrying on.
The Metropolitan Police, and I don't know what it is.
Evacuate now.
We're going to have to evacuate now.
The police are live with us now, and they're telling us that we've got to evacuate.
I don't see why we could possibly have to move.
So I'm very sorry to say that it is good evening for me for the time being, as I think that was probably a controlled explosion in the background. That's what it sounded like to me. We will no doubt find out later, but I assume as it's happened.
I'm sorry, but you can't get much more British than that. Neither of them, when the explosion went off, even batted an eyelid. And the fact that He's actually gobbing off to the police. Well, I don't see why we have to move, blah, blah. It's actually quite funny because they don't know what's going on outside. It could have been a terrorist attack. And they're like, no, we will continue. Now, some people actually saw this happen live on GB News, but like myself, I actually saw it on Twitter later on where people were sharing the clip. But someone actually shared this, and I have to say it did make me snigger a little bit near, and I sprayed my coffee across the room. This is a photograph of the person, the intruder, that is trying to throw explosives at Buckingham Palace. Now, there's been quite a few interviews that have been aired as well. Princess Anne has starred in her very own 30-minute interview with Canadian broadcaster CBBC with Adrian Arsenault. Princess Anne has been applauded for her humorous and no-nonsense attitude. Her attitude and outlook on life, she seems to be the perfect combination of her father, Prince Philip's attitude, and then the late Queen. Whilst I haven't watched the interview in full, I did see some clips. Princess Anne brought up slavery, and she thinks that it may not necessarily be the best idea for Charles recently, who has agreed to do an investigation between the monarchy and links to slavery. The problem is, I understand why Charles is answering calls to do this, but he's never going to appease the people that are screaming from the rooftops until he bows down, pays reparations, and gives in to all of their demands. And then after that's been done, it will happen all over again. There is always going to be demands for people that want something. And whilst slavery is a stain on our history, the same people seem to forget everything that the monarchy and the UK did in fighting in abolishing slavery. You have got the UK that actually passed the act due to campaigning by William Wilberforce that went through Parliament to abolish slavery in 1807 across the British Empire. In 1808, the UK formed the West Africa Squadron, which protected the coastline of Africa against other countries' slave ships. There is so much in UK history where we actually fought to abolish slavery, and then the people that are screaming the loudest, Americans, they didn't actually abolish slavery until 1860. So again, there seems to be a lot of hatred coming from America, which is being directed at the UK. And I think that Charles could sit down, he could privately fund a 6-hour Netflix documentary talking about all of the things with historians from all around the world, telling the audience everything that the UK actually did to help abolish it. And the same people are never going to be appeased because they are not going to stop until you give down to their demands. We're seeing this across all different social aspects now. It just seems to be the way of the world. So I do think Charles is kicking a hornet's nest and he's still not going to appease the people that he's trying to. And another good point that Princess Anne brought up was to do with the number of working senior royals. Charles has obviously tried to slim down the monarchy, which obviously this is a good thing because there have been too many members of the royal family that are having far too many privileges that were taxpayer funded. Charles has ejected people out of larger residences. He's trying it now with Andrew, with Royal Lodge. There's lots of cutbacks, which I'm sure have happened behind the scenes. And I think overall, the public are quite positive, having a positive reaction to Charles doing this. However, there then comes a problem where there's not enough feet on the ground, as it were. The Queen and Prince Philip had over 1,000 patronages and charities between them. So there is still, I'd imagine, across all of the senior working royals that we have still, there's got to be a couple of thousand in total. Now, you've got an older generation. The Prince and Princess Michael of Kent retired a couple of years ago. So now that you've got left that are senior working royals, who I am sure we will see on the balcony, is you will have Princess Anne, who is 72. Then you have Princess Alexandra, the Duke and Duchess of Gloucester, and then the Duke of Kent, and he's 87. So their age ranges are between 72 and 87. So there is going to come a point in the next few years that they will obviously retire and step back. So when Catherine and William are soon to take the throne, there's not going to be that many working royals unless they start bringing more of them into the fold. Now, I do understand from a taxpayer's point of view, we don't want to be paying for lots of members of the royal family that are already multimillionaires to travel around the country and live a life of luxury. However, when it comes to, I think the biggest costs are paying for their security. And as it stands now, it's only Charles and Queen Camilla, William and Catherine that have taxpayer funded security full time. The others only receive that when they are on official duties. But later on, who knows, maybe we might see Lady Louise, the Earl of Wessex, or even Beatrice and Eugenie, who already have a couple of their own personal patronages anyway. We might see them take on more of a role to represent the crown and take on more patronages. For people that don't understand why it's important and why so many organisations and charities contact the royal family on a yearly basis and beg them to come visit or to be an actual royal patron, it's because it brings much needed attention and publicity to what otherwise are small and unknown charities. There's lots of videos that I've done where we're seeing charities that I've never even heard of them, or I've heard of them, but I've got no idea what they actually do. Having a visit by a member of the royal family, especially a well-publicised one, where photographs end up in the media, it's so much more than just having a photograph and a handshake. It actually publicises what the charity does. It helps give them more support and donations. So I would like to think that Charles is not going to cut off Princesses Eugenie and Beatrice from carrying out engagements, and maybe Zara and Mike. There are certain things that I hope that Charles lets them pick up. But if they are going to be representing the crown and the monarchy, then it doesn't need to cost taxpayers millions of pounds. They are millionaires in their own right. They can pay for their own security. And it's just a case of when they are on official royal engagements, then taxpayer funded security. I've got no qualms with that. It costs like £1 a year or something ridiculous. It's the least of my worries. I'm more concerned with MPs and footballers' salaries, in all honesty. Now, in another interview that has gone out was the Spotlight Markle clan interview. I haven't, again, watched all of it. I've been a busy bee. I've been studying for the last couple of days. And what I got from the bits that I did see, I skimmed through some of it, is you've got a family that are just trying to put their side across. There was nothing really that was divulged, that was scandalous. You know, it was just typical advertising for clickbait. But you do see a family that's still trying to defend themselves. Many people have said that they should have not taken money for interviews, but I think why not? They were absolutely vilified by the media in the beginning, and Harry and Meghan aided that. The fact that they cut them off from the wedding stirred it all up. If Meghan's family had come to the wedding, there wouldn't have been anywhere near as much drama. If Meghan had actually got on a plane and spoken to Thomas Markle, there wouldn't have been anywhere near as much drama. But Meghan thrives on the drama, and it caused people to speculate the family must be truly awful if they weren't even invited to the wedding. So Meghan did definitely stir that pot, and as far as I'm concerned, Meghan can talk about the royal family feeding her to the wolves, but in fact, I believe it was Meghan that fed her own family to the wolves. It paints her out to be a victim, the fact that she's cut her father off. It's Meghan's right to cut her father off. Yes, it's anyone's right to cut off their family. But for Meghan to have done it in a way that it was so public and to never answer it, to try and defuse it, means that she wanted that continuation of the drama. People need to remember that they didn't ask for any of this. They didn't ask for their daughter to track down, hunt down and marry a prince and come into the royal family. They didn't ask for the media to suddenly start dissecting her family. And they grew in interest of the Markle side when Meghan refused to invite any of them to the wedding. So, as I said, I think if they can make money out for their association of being with Meghan and afford themselves a slightly better life, then I say fair play to them and go for it. Now, rumours are gaining that Harry might be a no-show, because reports have come out that Harry has not told the palace, despite saying through his publicist that he will be attending. He's not told them when he's coming, where he's staying, where he's leaving. Is he happy with his seats? So he's being childish to the very end. Now, I can't see the point in him coming, because he's flying from presumably Miami to the UK. Or he's getting a private jet direct from Montecito. Whatever his journey is going to be, he's saying that he's going to turn up for a couple of hours, which is a long-ass flight, to then go back and get back for his four-year-old son's birthday. He's not going to get back till 8-9 o'clock at night, I'd imagine, with the time frame. And that's providing that they take off on time and there's no problems at the airport, or they get stuck on the runway. There's all sorts of things, as anyone who's ever tried to catch a flight, that can delay stuff. So I do think there might be a chance that Harry, to be more dramatic, is just going to change his mind last minute and say, do you know what, I'm not going to go, just because it then turns up Harry no show in the headlines. Now, speaking of no show, and where I'm going to end the video, that's the title of this video, the Met Gala. Apparently, Meghan was a no show. Yes, so the way that they're trying to sell it is Meghan was invited to the Met Gala, but at the last minute, they couldn't make it work. These are all the different articles that have come out. I'm mishmashing them all together, but this is the general narrative that they're trying to sell. That Meghan declined purely because she didn't want any more attention on herself. I'm like, yeah, and pigs might fly. I mean, come on, seriously, Meghan turning down the Met Gala. I did think when I saw a cat appear on the Met Gala, I did wonder, is she trying to sneak in there? But as it turned out, no, not Doja Cat. She was the other cat. That was a creepy, weird outfit. Yes, the theme for this year's Met Gala was Karl Lagerfeld. And this is actually Jared Leto, who came dressed as Karl Lagerfeld's cat, Choupette. What an outfit. But I think, yeah, Harry and Meghan try and outdo that one. They could have tried and snuck down the carpet. I don't think that they were invited to the Met Gala. I don't believe that they wouldn't show up to that. I don't think that Anna Wintour, who had a great respect and fondness for the Queen, would particularly want Meghan marching down the Met Gala. And if you're not in with Anna Wintour, then you are definitely not in. But one tiny guest that turned up, which must add insult to injury for Meghan, was even a cockroach got their very own Met Gala appearance.
Hey guys, he's hungry. Get a photo. Get a photo. Kevin, get a photo. Kevin, get a photo. Yeah.
Woo! So there you go. A cockroach got photographed on the Met Gala carpet, but Meghan yet again didn't. Absolutely fantastic, and what a way to end a video. I will be back with you soon, and I will be trying to stay on top of all of the royal news. So take care for now. Bye.